Hey everyone, welcome to Online Youth Tonight. This is technically episode 32, but doing it online, it's actually episode 3. So I'm glad you found us. It is May, if you can believe it, and I have a question. Are we having fun yet? I don't know what your week has been like, but for me, this is a pretty good indicator. As much as I love roller coasters, this is one I'd love to get off, but I don't think that's possible anytime soon. We're gonna move on to seeing another leader's home, but before that, here's a couple of things that made me go, this week. Things that make you things that make you go, things that make you go, yeah. I don't know how many of you like watching late night talk shows, but as with everyone, they are recording them from home. I really like James Corden, who does the Late Late Show, and there was a segment that he did recently called Face Your Mother, and I thought it would be great to do something like this here. Now, we're not going to actually have any of your mothers online here, do not worry, but basically he would ask them a couple of questions, and they would see how their son or their daughter, in this particular one, it was how their son responded. So I thought we could try that in a simpler way, and so here's the two questions that James asked, and you can just type in your answer on the chat. So here's the first question. Do you think your mom has done any snooping around in your room? Let us know your answer. So here's the second question. Do you think your mom has ever hidden a past job that they have done from you? So there's no teleprompter here, but it's saying to insert new segment, and I'm not really sure.
And now it's time for Random GIFs with Larry, the part of the show where Larry comes out and shows you a random GIF.
Everybody love everybody! Come on!
This has been Random GIFs with Larry. Tune in next time when you'll hear Larry say,
Everybody love everybody! Come on!
Well, I suppose that works. Moving on. Now, this week I heard some news here at the meeting place that kind of made me go, this is likely an opportunity for us as youth to get involved. Question, how many of you like sandwiches? I love eating sandwiches, but I also love making sandwiches. In fact, this is my little sandwich press. This is one of the greatest things that I've ever purchased. Now, next week, hopefully if all goes well, we are going to do a Love Moves Winnipeg initiative, and we're going to form something called the Sandwich Squad, and here's why. There's many organizations out there that provide food and shelter and clothing for people in need, and there's a really big need right now for food and for food preparation. And so we've received a grant here at the meeting place where we can use it towards helping feed those who are hungry. And so we can have 10 people in our building at once. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna have 10 of you guys come, and we're gonna spend, I don't know how long, a bit of time together just making sandwiches. We're gonna lay them out on tables, we'll play some music, we'll get to see each other in person, which is fantastic. And this is something that's gonna go on for a couple of weeks. So it actually is gonna become a part of youth. But we'll have to make a schedule. We still have to figure out what the details look like. But we're putting this under the Love Moves initiative. So Love Moves Winnipeg, the Sandwich Squad. If this is something you're interested in, please type interested in the chat beside us, and we'll let you know more details as we go forward. Now, let's take another look at a leader's house. This is a 3-in-1 special.
To my house. It's my house. Hi, friends. This is my house. But more importantly, that's my car. Anyways, come with me. I'll show you my house. We call this the Narnia light. I've got it set up on a timer at night. The lights come on. Ooh. Our front steps, my front door. Come on. And here's my cat. Come on in. I'm not gonna hurt you. There's my cat. Best cat ever. This cat waits for me at the front door. That's my wife. This is my entranceway. This is where we sit and watch church on Sunday mornings. To the couches on this TV here. That's what the wall is. Anyways, there you go. We'll go down this way. I'll show you the bedrooms first. These are pictures. Come. This is the cave that's called Abraham's room. Boop, boop. Okay. This is our bathroom. I built this myself. Big soaker tub. It's nice and fancy. This is my bedroom. That's as far as you're going to see there. This is Amanda's bedroom. We don't have a room here. There we go. Now we're walking backwards. Watch my cat. There we go. There's Annika's plant. It's going to fall from the ceiling because she didn't hook it up properly in there. She's lucky it's not going to hit her on the head. This is our little dining room. It's where we eat our meals together every single day and evening. Let's turn the light on. Oh, we've got a cool feature. Hey, Google, turn on the lights. They all laughed. This is our kitchen. I built it myself. This is our favorite child. Cut it in. Abraham is holding the camera and he's in shock, but she works really hard at it.
Facts are facts.
We love them all equally, but we have a favorite. It's okay, I still love you, buddy. Look, the cat's following us. Where's the cat's food? Where'd you get the cat's food? It doesn't matter. Come on.
My room's not in it.
Don't show the outside. Don't show the outside. It just makes Annika angry. Just makes Annika angry. Don't put your outside. Come on.
Show
me. What are you doing that? I told you.
No, wait. We have this caution tape. Show them the caution tape, please. This one little yellow piece of tape.
So, hi. Now we're in our basement. This is our bed. You can come in. This is probably one of the most expensive steppers you could buy back in 1999. You can see it clearly. It gets a lot of use. Okay, so this is our workout area. Our treadmill and our weights. Catherine's clothes. Fish tank in the wall. Cool. Take one.
You can't do it.
Office. And then the laundry room over there. Come on. Did you reverse
it? Get out of here.
Come on.
Get out of here.
Oh, we can show the backyard, but not your bedroom?
I'm in the process of taking care of my room. You're not in the process of taking care of your backyard.
That's our laundry room in there. And that's our home. Nice and simple.
Thanks for the tour, Steve. It was great to see your house. And thank you, Abraham, for doing the filming for us. Now, Ryan is here with me once again. And once again, we're going to play How Long Was It Stuck? So here's my question for Ryan tonight. Ryan, how long was the movie Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone stuck in the number one position? Go.
That's the first one? That's the first Harry Potter?
Yeah. 4 weeks. 2 weeks. No, you're close.
1.5 weeks.
I'm sorry, Ryan. That is not the correct answer. You were so close. We were looking for 3 weeks. Now, you guys know what's happening. It is time to find out who is going to get another McBee's delivery tonight. So your question is this. How many weeks was the song Old Town Road stuck in the number one position? Type in your answer to the right, and you could get a McBee's delivery tonight. That was a lovely rhyme. Well, hopefully that wasn't too hard for you. I'll be seeing one of you tonight. Now, for those who know me well, you know that I'm a big fan of the 80s. And so here's just a fun question. Does anybody know who this is? If you guessed Marty McFly, you would be right. And so today, we need to go back to the 80s for our grade 9 story.
What a handsome young lad, eh? Totally appropriate for whatever time period that that photo was from. Oh, it's hard to believe that at that time, the things that I was into are things that you really, a lot of you wouldn't understand, because I mean, I know I'm not really old, but you know, I'm old enough that nothing's the same. Like, I spent a lot of my time watching a show that was like 5 years old at the time called The Simpsons, which was, it was a kind of a comedy show. It was, you know, some people didn't necessarily like it because it had some humor that was, you know, parents didn't always love it, but it was something that I really enjoyed when I got home from school. What else? In hockey, the Pittsburgh Penguins were a really good team with a guy called Jaromir Jagr. And I know that, you know, the Penguins aren't any good anymore. Oh, and there was a show that was just starting in that was really, really popular. You've probably never heard of it, called Friends. And it was about a group of friends who got together and just acted all, you know, friendly and had some fun and that sort of thing. So yeah, things have changed quite a bit since my time in grade 9. And you know, I always try to be honest with you guys, aside from when I'm joking. And so I have to say that I didn't like my grade 9 experience at all. It was bad. So I'm gonna genuinely save that for a conversation later, because I really do want to share about, you know, the not fun times that I had in school. However, the whatever time period I was born were a lot of fun. So as a little bit of a game just for me, I'm going to tell you some things that, you know, happened and were in my life at the time that I was in grade 9. That's right. So let's see the internet here. Okay. Okay. So there was this lady called Tanya Harding, who was like a Olympic figure skater. And there was like a lady who was a bit better than her at an old figure skating sort of thing. And so, you know, Olympians are usually classy, you know, all together sort of thing. Well, she paid someone to club this other lady in the knee. And that was big news, because like, who does that? And how are you not caught? So that was big news there. That was pretty funny and also not good. Now, not funny, but also very good. What, and very interesting to know this happened so soon in South Africa. It was the first multiracial elections they ever had. So in South Africa, in the year I did this, South Africa had recently got rid of that horrible type of government where it was illegal for anyone besides, you know, white people to be any sort of important person, and this was the first year. So that was actually, that was a pretty important year in my grade 9 years. Netscape Navigator was one of the big ways to surf the interweb where you could connect and get information and share things for free with everybody. It was going to be a utopia, and I think that pretty much happened. The internet's free, and everything is easy, and people are kind and generous to each other, so that all happened. O.J. Simpson, if you've heard of that guy, did some bad things, and he kind of got filmed driving away from police in a white Ford Bronco, which was big news, but it also started the big era of sensationalized news, so that's less good. So yeah, you know what, in the year, I think there were a lot of people had up and down years, just like I did, but a lot of stuff happened, and there were some wildfires in Montana, that wasn't very good, the first Lion King came out in this given year, and I won't sing all the popular songs that were, you know, popular in this year, just because I don't want to ruin them for you. But yeah, that was me in grade 9, and thanks for listening to me, and I'll talk to you guys later.
Well, thanks so much, Greg, for sharing your story with us. The 80s were a totally rad decade. And if you happen to see that movie, you would know that Marty McFly did not get stuck in the 50s. Speaking of stuck, this is our last week in this series. And last week we heard a stuck story from Annika, and now we've got another one from Dave.
Hey everyone, I'm David, and I'm gonna tell you guys about a time when I was stuck. So, when I was stuck is actually kind of right now. There's a lot of things going on that aren't going exactly the way that I planned them. This spring is supposed to be a time when I was going to graduate and I was going to get my degree, and I was also in a month and a half or so going to get married, and I was going to have a big wedding and it was going to be great. So that's kind of where I'm stuck, is that nothing is really going exactly the way that I planned it. With graduation, there's a bunch of ceremony and all sorts of things that normally mark a graduation that are no longer happening. And with my marriage, kind of have to change that, because groups definitely can't be that big, that's for sure. But anyhow, what made me feel stuck is just this feeling of being out of control, not being able to choose the way things would go anymore. Or just having plans like my wedding plan just come to a halt, and I don't know what to do, and I don't know if there is any like right answer of what to do. It kind of leaves me feeling like things are happening, but nothing's really changing. Like I'm still done my school, but it doesn't feel like I graduated. So now I just want you guys to take your hands and just close them. So this is kind of what I was like, holding my hands tight and closed around the plan that I had, and that's not really what God wants us to be like. I wanted everything to happen the way I had planned it, and that's not how it's going to happen. It's not really up to me. So now just open your hands. So now with your hands open, this is how God wanted me to be. He wanted me to trust Him with my plans and let Him have them, because they might not work out exactly the way I had planned for them to go. One thing I know, actually two things I know, I will graduate and I will get married. And these are the things that I do know. And those are the things that are most important and what I built my plans around. So knowing that definitely takes some of the pressure off of having everything go exactly the way I want it. I just want to close with a verse from James. James 4, 13 to 17. So it says, "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin." Okay, so some of that applied to me directly and some of it did not. But anyhow, the part about planning really did. And I do not know what will happen tomorrow. Earlier this year, I didn't know that there was going to be a pandemic that would change all my plans. And that's just the way it went. and having my hands open and letting God take control of that is definitely helping me to be okay with those changes.
Thank you so much, David, for sharing your story with us. We wish you and Sierra all the best as you finalize your wedding details. Now, the past 2 weeks, we talked about a guy named Joseph who was stuck in prison, but even though he made good choices. We also talked about Jonah, who found himself stuck in the belly of a fish and did really the only thing that he could do, and that was to pray. We're going to move on over to the New Testament now, and we're going to look a little bit at the life of Paul. Now, at the beginning of his life, he was a guy who hated Christians, who hated anybody who believed in Jesus. And so he would have them persecuted, he would have them thrown in jail, he would even have them killed. Well, one day he found himself going to a city of Damascus, and this bright light came and shone so brightly that it blinded him. But the incredible thing was, a voice spoke to him, and it was the voice of Jesus himself that said, "Why are you persecuting me? Why are you harming all the believers?" And so God had a plan for Saul, for Paul's life. And so Paul went to Damascus, he got the healing that he needed, and then he dedicated his life to spread the good news of Jesus to the places around. He was the very first missionary. In fact, he went on 3 very significant missionary journeys, and during this time, he actually wrote a lot of the New Testament. Now, there are also many times that Paul found himself stuck, and stuck big time. One of the times he found himself stuck was shipwrecked. He was on his way to Rome to stand before Caesar to appeal charges that were sent his way. Paul was also in chains many times, stuck in prison. Even though Paul was stuck in prison, he chose to worship God. He chose to praise God. And he wrote many of the New Testament books like Ephesians, where we spent a lot of time in, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. Now, in 2 Corinthians, we find this verse. "I was given a thorn in my body because of the outstanding revelations I've received, so that I wouldn't be conceited. It's a messenger from Satan sent to torment me so that I wouldn't be conceited." This verse has always been very interesting to me. He had a thorn stuck in his side. Now, we don't know if this was like a physical thorn. I kind of doubt that, but it was something that caused him grief, that caused him anguish, that caused him pain, that kept him humble. So that was just a very short overview of Paul's life. Now, of course, that was then, and this is now, and chances are you won't find yourself stuck in a shipwreck, or hopefully not stuck in prison, although I suppose that could happen. But what about that thorn in the flesh that he felt stuck with? It says that the enemy, Satan, came to send that thorn as a messenger to torment him. Do you feel tormented by anything? Perhaps you're stuck in this cycle of thoughts that just keep replaying in your head, making you feel worthless or unlovable. Perhaps you're tormented by some kind of sin that you feel overwhelmed and defeated by. Or perhaps porn and sexual behavior is something that's really stuck with you and you feel ashamed and you feel guilty. Or maybe you've done something to someone and you feel stuck in guilt. Or maybe somebody's done something to you and you feel ashamed. There's a lot of stuff that goes on in our lives. A lot of stuff that we can stay stuck in. But God doesn't want us to be stuck in these thought patterns, in the feelings of guilt and being ashamed and feeling worthless and unloved. We can get unstuck. It's not necessarily going to be easy, but the first step is to talk to someone. Now, I'm going to show you a clip from a show that I am not endorsing in any way. The show is called 13 Reasons Why, and it's a very, very difficult show to watch. I know many of you have watched it. I'm not encouraging you to watch it. It's a tough one to watch. And in season 3, there was one scene in particular. I was watching it on the treadmill, and I just had tears. I wanted to show this scene because it just shows what it's like to get unstuck. You're going to see a character who finally is able to share the things that he's been holding inside. And it's tough stuff because stuff was done to him. Now, I edited it. There was a sexual assault that he was involved in, and he describes it. I took it out of the scene. But I also want you to pay attention to how he is responded to. Here it is.
Tyler, what is it?
I can't.
Okay. Okay, you don't have to. But you can tell me. You know that, right? You know I care about you. And at this point, you can tell me anything.
I was in the bathroom when I got back from my diversion program. Monty came in and he was mad about the field and he smashed my head on the mirror and on the sink, and then he and Taylor and Kenneth, they held my head in the toilet and
I'm so sorry that happened to you. I feel like I want to hug you right now. Would that be all right if I hug you?
One thing I'm really impressed with is how these actors portray these characters. And these are just stories that are presented. However, these stories hit really close to home, especially in your age group. You see, Tyler was stuck with these thoughts, and it got to the point where he just wanted to end his life. But he took the step to talk to someone, and I just loved Clay's response when he said, "I'd really like to give you a hug now. Would that be okay?" What incredible release, what incredible freedom is available. And that's just a show on TV. God grieves for you. God wants to take your burdens and offer you freedom. He wants to let you know you are loved. You are adopted into his family. You are cherished. You know, I know some of you might be stuck. Some of you might be stuck right now. Some of you might be stuck in some form of sin that just has its claws in you. Some of you might be stuck in those thought patterns that are just consuming your mind. It's time to get unstuck. It might not be your time tonight, but perhaps it is. And I would encourage you to talk to your small group leader. That's why we're here. And if talking on Zoom isn't, you know, the best place for you to do that, I get that. But perhaps call your leader during the week. Perhaps just send them a text saying, "Hey, I'd love to talk to you." Feel free to send me a text or call me as well. Getting unstuck is not easy, and there is a right time and a right place. I have a quote that I want to read you. "Don't be deceived into believing that you are not better than what you've been stuck in." I'll say it again. "Don't be deceived into believing that you are not better than what you've been stuck in." God has promised he will never leave you or forsake you. We're going to close with another song. And this song beautifully talks about what it means to get unstuck, what it means to let the love of Jesus come and wash over your heart and your mind and clean up the those hidden places. I'd encourage you to listen to the words. You don't need to watch the video. You can close your eyes. And then we'll see you all back in Zoom very shortly.
Precious blood has left me forgiven. Jesus, my heart is clean, so I